Hachette Audio presents Disposable City, Miami's Future on the Shores of Climate Catastrophe. Written by Mario Alejandro Ariza. Read by Ron Butler. To Catherine Stein, without whose love and companionship it could not have been written, and to the great-grandchildren of Annie Baez de Guerra. When the waters come, please know you had kin who fought like hell to keep them from your door. Part 1. Sinking City. 1. What we talk about when we talk about Miami. Miami forever. I can't imagine my son or my grandchildren living anywhere else, said the mayor of Miami to the former United Nations Secretary General. Perfectly tanned and impeccably coiffed, Francis Suarez was leading the soft-spoken Ban Ki-moon on a circuit of the city's dazzling downtown urban core. Seated next to each other on the hard-backed wooden benches of a City of Miami trolley packed with reporters and civil servants, the pair discussed the uncertain future of the Magic City as the ungainly vehicle trundled along narrow downtown streets. It was February 2019, and I sat behind them, listening as they spoke about the future of my city. Ban, current head of the Global Commission on Adaptation, took as a given that climate change was happening, that it was having serious negative consequences, and that it was time to get smart about mitigating impacts. Like an aging rock star who'd hired a new band and written a comeback album, Ban and his global commission were on a world tour. Their first stop was Miami, a city that, as you may have heard, is probably doomed. But the metropolis at the tip of southeast Florida, set to drown in the rising sea by the end of the 21st century, was not going down without a fight. We want to be the most resilient city on the planet and a model for resiliency around the world, the mayor told Ban as the trolley arrived at its first destination, a giant pump, smack in the middle of the Brickell Financial District, a pump powerful enough to drain a swimming pool's worth of water every minute. Across the street from the gleaming pump rose the towers of Brickell City Center, a $1.5 billion development owned by Swire Properties. Swire had recently announced an expansion of the complex. They believe in the future of the city, boasted the mayor. Impressive, affirmed Ban. It was the nicest, shiniest, most capable pump I'd seen. None of the people present commented on the fact that it was conveniently located next to one of the area's most expensive commercial properties. Alan Dodd, the director of the City of Miami's Department of Resilience and Public Works, and a former colonel in the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, pointed out that the pump was connected to a giant sump, an underground chamber that cleaned the water the pump drained before moving it to the ecologically vulnerable Biscayne Bay. He then instructed one of his employees to open the gate to the sump, allowing everyone to peer into the vast cistern. As I listened to the water trickling down into the sump's cavernous depths, all I could wonder was, will it be enough? In the middle of the Middle Kingdom. I started writing this book in the summer of 2015, though I didn't know it at the time. I was teaching English in Zhengzhou, China. Zhengzhou is what the Chinese term a second-tier city, a metropolis of 8 million people that functions as the Middle Kingdom's equivalent of Cincinnati, Ohio. To me, climate change was, up until that summer, a vague nagging, a topic I could learn about later, maybe, when I had the time. And then one high summer morning, in the middle of Hunan province, at the center of the Middle Kingdom, on what otherwise should have been an unremarkable day, I stepped outside and found myself unable to see the skyscrapers on the other side of the street. I could barely see the sun. The black, acrid smog was that nebulous and thick. It stayed that way, inexplicably hazy, ominously overcast, difficult to inhale, for days. Even with a breathing mask, it felt like I was swallowing handfuls of cigarette ash every time I opened my mouth. I could smell what humans were doing to the earth. It smelled like exhaust. I could taste it. It tasted like ash. I could breathe it, but just barely. The thick haze covered more than just Zhengzhou. That summer, I traveled across the breadth of China, from Shenzhen in the south to Beijing in the north, and the smoke and haze followed everywhere I went. This was more than mere pollution. This was climate change. But what did it mean for my plan to move back to Miami at the end of the summer? A city whose vulnerability was already making headlines. What you're reading is the fruit of the research that I started in that Zhengzhou hotel room, with my laundry drying in the bathroom and the high summer sun obscured by smog. In the course of writing, I've interviewed more than 150 sources, made half a dozen public records requests, reported on two hurricanes, helped catch a python, kayaked up the Miami River, investigated a nuclear power plant, and followed in the wake of quixotic public officials showing off a shiny new piece of infrastructure meant to hold back the inexorably rising tide. This book's title comes from a conversation I had with a lobbyist in January 2017 while working as a freelancer for a local media outlet on a story about affordable housing. On the phone with Ben Solomon, a squint-eyed, blonde-haired real estate lawyer who sits at the nexus of power of realtors, construction companies, and developers in a city run by realtors, construction companies, and developers, we talked for almost 45 minutes. Even though Miami was in the midst of a housing crisis, he poo-pooed the idea of the county mandating that developers build affordable homes. The state legislature would later take away municipalities' power to do such pesky things. Close to the end of the conversation, I asked him, tangentially, what he thought about all this climate change stuff. He started talking about Miami as if it were a patient suffering from a terminal disease. Look, the press, the city, everybody here needs to have a good bedside manner about this issue of climate change, Solomon said. Sea level rise is definitely going to affect the market here, he assured me. I just hope that this thing is far enough away that we still have at least 5 or 6 good business cycles left. Solomon's cynical calculation shocked me. Property development, as we will see, is big business in Miami. But developers don't often hold onto a building for very long after they complete it, so they're relatively insulated from the risk of constructing thousands of condominiums in a city with a shrinking future. The conversation with Solomon cued me into one of the fundamental conflicts around climate change that this book seeks to address. For too long, discussions about what humans are doing to the climate system have been framed in terms of belief or disbelief. That's created a situation in which a vast asymmetry of information exists. Cynical actors are taking advantage of that asymmetry. For them, climate change isn't about believing or not believing. It's about winning or losing, and they plan to win. Many of these cynical actors have little immediate incentive to mitigate carbon emissions. Some don't even feel compelled to adapt. Perhaps they think they'll die of old age before climate change gets too bad, or that they have enough money to protect themselves from its effects. But all of the people who don't understand what is going to happen with the climate are going to get screwed. As Los Angeles and San Francisco burn with wildfire, as Phoenix broils, as Jakarta sinks into the sea, as Johannesburg and Chennai, India, stumble from thirst, human-driven climate change presents Miami, unique among them, with a looming existential threat. Porous local geology means that there is no stopping rising water here. The region's policymakers, politicians, and local stakeholders either minimize the problem or preach a gospel of resilience and optimism out of touch with the situation's gravity. The media is struggling to clearly communicate the risks to the public. At stake, in the South Florida region alone, are 6.5 million lives, hundreds of billions of dollars in real estate, and the place I call home. A sponge in water. Former mayor of Miami, Maurice Ferre, was giving a speech. It was January 2019. Ferre was dying of cancer.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.